आप
I see the participants are joining very rapidly. We already have about 41. Hi Amit, welcome. Our moderator is also here. Amit, welcome.
Hi. Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good to see Dr. Dev and Mr. Nath together.
Yes. No, we sat together on CRC bench.
I know. That's exactly why I said. Exactly why I said. It's been a long time.
A long time, yes.
So, Nicole, will you kick it off? Rita?
Rita and I will kick it off in a few minutes. Yeah. I think we are just expecting the rest of our panelists.
Sure. Thank you.
Who I'm sure will join momentarily.
Okay.
Okay, and the other thing is, can we off video? No. This is mute.
We'll just give Mr. Gupta and Ashish a couple of minutes to join, and then we'll start. Supratim had let us know in advance that he'll join a little later. So just give us a minute. So Rita, I think perhaps we can get underway and the others will join as we go ahead. Over to you, Rita.
Yeah, okay, great. So good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this webinar on effective dispute resolution in the Indian power sector. This is the first in the series that Fiki is kicking off on current discussions in the electricity sector under the aegis of the Fiki Power Committee. We have with us a very, very distinguished set of speakers here with us today. And Mr. Vipul Tuli, Chairman, Fiki Power Committee, Managing Director, Sembcorp Energy India Limited, has really been instrumental in guiding us to this particular webinar topic. We also have Mr. Praveen Yogi, who's the mentor of the Fiki Power Committee, Chief Advisor of the RP Sanjeev Goenka Group with us today. Welcome also to Mr. Sanjay Malhotra, Additional Secretary, Ministry of Power, Government of India, who's the chief guest and will be speaking later after the panel discussion, which will be among a very eminent set of panelists. And our chief moderator for the panel discussion is Mr. Ajay Kapoor, a very well-known person in the legal fraternity, member of the Fiki Power Committee and joint managing partner of JSR Associates. I just want to mention that we will have an interactive session after the panel discussion, first with Mr. Sanjay Malhotra, and then we'll have an open Q&A session. We'll request all participants to either raise their hands in the Q&A box or post their questions in the Q&A. So, I invite the chair of the Fiki Power Committee to make his welcome remarks. Over to you, Mr. Tuli.
Thank you, Rita. And very good afternoon and very warm welcome to everyone. I see many industry colleagues and other colleagues from the sector in the audience. We have a very distinguished panel who really needs no introduction, but we'll have a proper introduction to them in a moment. And of course, my industry colleagues from the PAR committee who are also on. So very warm welcome to all of you. I think this is a very important discussion today. To not mince words, I would say the sector is in trouble. We have massive issues of liquidity, despite recent very prompt action on the part of the government to try and ease that problem. We have ongoing viability issues. And to top it, we have a very ambitious and very necessary energy transition that we've committed to as a country to also happen as we speak. In the midst of all this background, I think we are here today to discuss what is perhaps the most critical aspect of this sector, given that this is a highly, highly regulated sector. So the aspect of the legal framework and particularly the dispute resolution framework within that. So if we have to think about what does a truly healthy power sector look like, I can think of few other tools or few other areas of focus to restore the health of the sector than the regulatory and dispute resolution institutions and mechanisms. So this is very crucial to all of our lives in the sector, what we are discussing today. Of course, we all know that a very far-reaching set of Electricity Act amendments have been proposed. They've been in the works for a while, and we're very conscious that currently they're sort of at the final stages and hope to be enacted into law soon. And within that, dispute resolution and regulatory mechanisms, focus of those amendments. Many views have been expressed, many positions have been taken around that. And so with this background, we thought it would be useful from the FICCI PAR committee and helpful to the sector to organize a thoughtful, reflective discussion, but really bring on people who have real depth, real credibility, real respect in the sector. And so we do have generators who are joining us. We have former regulators. In fact, some of our earliest regulators are here with us today. We have the legal fraternity well represented. We have former, I think some of our regulators have also been former state policymakers from their days in the states. And we'll also be joined by representatives of the banking community. So it's quite a holistic representation. Maybe we could have had more people from the DISCOM side, but we'll try to make sure that perspective also does get reflected. And so I look forward to the next couple of hours. And with that, I'd like to invite and hand over to Amit Kapoor, our moderator, who again really needs no introduction. He's a senior partner and joint managing director with GSA. And I think he's been involved with the sector for a while, is well familiar with Amit. So thank you, Amit, for agreeing to moderate this, and over to you.
Thank you, Vipul. Thank you, Rita. Welcome to everybody. In context of what's been stated and the richness of what follows, I would not take too much except to simply introduce the format I was thinking of, because we have six very powerful speakers in this panel. We have starting from Mr. Rakesh Nath, Dr. Pramod Dev, Mr. A.K. Gupta, Vipul, and Supratim Sarkar, and finally, last but not the least for sure, because the final word lies with him, Mr. Sanjay Malhotra from Ministry of Power, who will take in the policy perspective and share with us how the progress has been. So I was proposing, since we have around an hour and a bit in this discussion with us, that I would request each of the speakers, and we could follow the sequence of starting with Dr. Dev, then Mr. Rakesh Nath, moving on to Mr. Gupta. Is Mr. Gupta joined us? Has he joined us? I don't see him around.
Mr. Gupta is unable to join us. Although we have Mr. Ashish Basu with us.
Oh, very good. So Mr. Ashish Basu is there. Very good. Excellent. So, Mr. Ashish Basu, followed by Supratim. And I would request each of you to give 5 minutes of your perspective on dispute resolution under the Electricity Act as it has been, and the proposed amendment versus any other perspectives that you may have. How do we secure efficacy? just as a backdrop, I'll just take 2 minutes. The basic issue, which has been highlighted and significantly recognized by now, is the fact that today, as we talk, around 40% of the NPAs in the country are directly, indirectly linked with the power sector. Most of these are caught in disputes at various levels of the regulatory institution, before regulators, before the tribunal, up to Supreme Court, back into implementation before the regulator. And the ultimate challenge has been that while electrons have flowed from the bus bar and been consumed, rupees have not necessarily flowed back to people who have spent that money. And that is causing a lot of distress to the banking sector as well as the investors. We have very ambitious targets of going forward. We have done very well as a country in terms of kickstarting the renewable journey. But we are now faced with a significant challenge that if the dispute resolution mechanism, which was meant to be an expert adjudication with an appellate body, which is also an expert body, so they would decide quickly with a deep understanding of the sector, not only from a legal point of view, but more from the technical and financial and economic perspective. We have challenges ahead of us. As a economy which is trying to get back restarted after this COVID episode and the projections for the future, we are going to need significant investments in the times ahead. And one of the biggest challenges India faces as an investment destination is the enforcement of contract. And you know our rankings in the global order. So in that context, may I start by inviting Dr. Pramod Dev. Dr. Pramod Dev, and in fact, none of the panelists need any introduction truly for the sector, but let me just take 2 minutes to tell you that he has over around 25 years of experience in power sector, initially on the policy side, working with the utilities. So while we may not have a DISCOM, but Dr. Dev also has worked on incumbent of Maharashtra. And he's a bit of a war hero for our sector, having battled through the Dabhol days and then come to being a regulator, then the central regulator. Dr. Dev also brings with us the experience of having handled regulation at the state level in Maharashtra, chairing it, and then coming to CERC. His contribution, amongst others, was the seminal judgment order of CERC in the case of NCDP and imported coal issue, where the Ultra Mega and other power projects came before CERC asking for restitution and compensation. That led to the Energy Watchdog judgment, which today holds the field and is the only judgment of any common law country where Supreme Court allowed compensation for change in law. Normally, change in law and force majeure are defense mechanisms in all common law countries. So over to you, Dr. Dev, for your perspective on dispute resolution, its efficacy, and what you're thinking on the future is.
Well, thank you, Amit. Based on my experience, what I would say is there is definitely a need for such an authority. How do we set it up is the matter. That's what we need to discuss. Because today, the share of private sector in generation is nearly 47%. And what has changed is earlier, it was the game of only the public sector, state and center, who were the players involved. And it was like a old Indian family, you know, where you could fight with each other without any much result. But now today, in this investment by private sector is on such a large scale. And it is not really the private sector. It is really the public financial institution who have contributed 75% of these funds which have gone into this power plant. And we had mutual problems that huge pendency of cases in the regulatory commission. And what I used to find, even as the regulator at the state and central level, it was very difficult to cope up with the number of cases which we were handling. And many of these cases arose because the DISCOM did not want to pay or meet their obligation. So you can always create a dispute. And obviously the private sector also had their own problem. So this was been the case. So I think the need for a dispute resolution authority and lessen the burden of regulatory commission is very important. In fact, whenever we used to take a review of pending cases, we found that it was very difficult to do justice to all the cases. It's not that it require much of legal knowledge. But the difficulty comes is that if the number is large and the basic function of the regulatory commission is the regulation making, and also related to that are the various matters that you had to do, the tariff determination, that itself takes so much of your time. So for these are the always put on the back burner. So there's a pendency increases. In fact, I know that after I had left CRC, there was a time when the PMO tried to ask CRC why there are so many cases pending. And obviously the commission did not like it. They said that this is an interference in the regulatory affairs. So need for a separate authority is definitely there. But the question is, how do we go about it? Because I thought one very simple solution was, since there is already law says that commissions can adjudicate or refer it for adjudication. So why not just take away this power of adjudicating it themselves and just refer it for adjudication under the new law? That could be one simple solution. Or other is that you have a separate body which goes into these matters, and all the adjudicatory functions of the regulatory commission, like section 29(5), 33(4), 57(2), 67(4) and 5, 79(1F), etc., etc., they all will be removed from the, and also then there will be no need to have a judicial member on the regulatory commission, because all these matters will be decided by electricity contract enforcement authority, whatever you name you give. So I think for the introduction, I will stop my thing. But the main point that arises is, since now there is an urgency to decide the number of pending issues, cases, and also regulators are not able to do full justice to that. So I think there is an urgent need to have a separate body for that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. May I now invite Mr. Rakesh Nath? Now, Mr. Rakesh Nath has another 15 years to add to him. He has over 40 years of experience in the sector. He's a power engineer. He started with Punjab State Electricity Board, Bhakra, and BBMB as the chairman. He has chaired the Central Electricity Authority. So had a, from the bottoms up, working through, sitting on boards of various leading public sector enterprises, including PTC, and then chairing the National Planner, which should plan for the country for the next 5 years. The EPS is written by that authority, setting standards for the grid operations, for the kind of installation of machinery and equipment that is needed, and various other advisory functions with the government. They also, before the Electricity Act 2003, had the techno-economic clearance function. Mr. Nath also, as a consequence, was an ex officio member on the CRC and sat in some important matters. Then he was invited and selected to be the technical member in the Appellate Tribunal for Electricity, where he had 2 tenures before he retired, and is continued to be associated as a much sought after advisor, also an arbitrator in the sector. So, Mr. Nath, may I request you to please share your views on how do you see the whole dispute resolution mechanism and the way forward as proposed?
Yeah, thank you, Amit. I think what the, as far as the dispute resolution is concerned, what the stakeholders are looking for is quick disposal and resolution of disputes by an authority which is perceived as independent by all stakeholders. Now, these are the two essential things. As Dr. Deb has pointed out, the delay in administration and justice is a concern for the development of the power sector. A lot of cases are piling up in the commission. And we do not blame the commissions and tribunal for the same, because cases are piling up, number of cases are increasing as more and more private players are coming into renewable sector. And also there are issues of filling up of the vacant post in time and manning of the staff to deal with the increasing number of cases. So these are the problem. I in my tenure in the tribunal, I think five and a quarter years. For about more than 2.5 years, we had only one technical member, and I used to sit on two benches by rotation. So the tribunal was in practically operating at 60% efficiency. So that resulted in piling up of the cases. Now, as far as the independence of the commission is, I think one of the main objectives, as stated in the statement of object and reasons, is distancing the regulatory responsibilities from the government. But not all commissions have inspired confidence in the minds of the stakeholders. And they have a feeling that the state governments have influence over the decisions being taken by the commissions. I don't say all commissions, but many of the commissions. The influence of the state commission can be traced back to the selection process of the members of the state commission, where the state government has larger influence on the selection of the members. As far as I think it is important to segregate the adjudication and the regulatory functions of the state commission, because I think for the dispute resolution, there should be an independent authority, a judicial authority, quasi-judicial authority on the pattern of tribunal with technical and judicial member. And the role of the state commission should be determination of tariff, granting license, making regulations, and also other things like specifying grid code, promote power markets, and also quality of supply, etc. And I find that due to large increasing number of cases, many of the important functions assigned to commissions are getting neglected, and like making new regulations in the changing environment when more renewable energy is integrating into the system. I think the model that is being proposed in the proposed amendment of creating ECEA, an Electricity Contract Enforcement Authority, there are certain weaknesses, because I think there is some judicial overlap between the functions of the commission and the and the proposed authority, and since the tariff determination and matters relating to tariff have been excluded from their jurisdiction, I think there is very little that this authority can do. Maybe certain cases relating purely contractual issues will be referred, like delaying completion of project, or say liquidity damages, or where the state authorities are asking for renegotiation of tariff after the tariff being discovered through competitive bidding, etc., etc. But if there are more than one issues, multiple issues, some relating to contractual matter, some relating to tariff determination or involving tariff, then there will be a problem, because then there will be two authorities, and we don't know whether there will be parallel dispute resolution and what. So I think some improvement is required in the present draft, in my view.
So thank you so much. May I now invite Mr. Ashish Basu to share his views. Ashish Basu is a senior professional, again, from the power sector, but this time the gentleman is from the generation side. He is the CEO of Energy Corporate and GMR Energy. He has over 25 years of experience working in the energy sector, and he's worked across the value chain, generation, transmission, distribution, as also in the coal mine development. He has significant insight into the contractual issues and project financing, and has worked at with multilateral agencies, other financial institutions, and negotiated several high-value contracts. So from the perspective of an investor, from the perspective of a developer, how do you see the current dispute resolution situation, Ashish, and what do you think of the proposed change? Any insights, any perspectives?
Good afternoon to you all. I will put it in three buckets. I think what ails or what is the problem with private sector are three. One is, of course, as the previous speakers have talked about, is the speed of resolution. That's one bucket. Another big bucket is that even if cases are resolved at the ERC level, there is no compliance of that. DISCOMs finds means and very creative means of challenging those orders. So one is how quickly the cases can be resolved. Second is, having resolved it, how to ensure ultimately that the cash flow comes in. Though Supreme Court has allowed carrying cost, there's nobody to fund this black hole. So I will, if I may, give my response in these two buckets. First is, as previous speakers say, Rakesh Nathji said, Pramod Deoji said, that the numbers have multiplied. So there is a need to increase capacity. To that extent, creation of this contract enforcement authority is very welcome. At the cost of oversimplifying, I thought the right approach would be, once a contract has been executed, let's say a PPA has been signed, it's a contract. So that contract, with all its disputes, be it tariff or otherwise, should be in the realm of contract enforcement authority. CRC, besides the regulation making, I think majorly it has to focus on market development, which it's doing, service standards, which it's doing. In terms of tariff determination under Section 62, where there is an expert technical body, it does the tariff determination. If we see majority of the cases which are outstanding, it would be change in law, tax, duties, or coal cost pass-through. Even CRC does not compute, it gives a formula. So I think, therefore, all the disputes of the contract, be it tariff or otherwise, once a contract is executed, either CRC has adopted the tariff and the PPA, or it's a cost plus contract, it's signed and sealed, any dispute thereunder goes to a contract enforcement authority for adjudication. That way, possibly, and Amit, you would have to reflect whether it's oversimplifying, there is jurisdiction overlap possibly can be avoided. So that's number one. In terms of capacity creation, there should be enough benches so that the need for speed is addressed. I was looking at APTEL number of cases. Based on website data, what can be derived, there are roughly 1,300 cases. In the last 6 years, 2016 to 20, 375 cases have been resolved. So that gives an understanding of the magnitude of the problem. So I think in the current Electricity Amendment Act, there's a suggestion to increase the number of APTEL members to minimum 7. I think section 112. We would urge that that number can be increased to 11 minimum, so that more benches can be created. Because going by the past speed, what is outstanding is nearly 3.5 years of work. And more disputes will come through. That was my second point on the need for speed. There's a third point. And there was an attempt to address it in the tariff policy, but not. And I would leave this point to Amit. Very frivolous issues are brought up to delay and challenge. A classic case, I will tell you, we have a PPA with a union territory called Dadra Nagar Haveli. GST compensation says, with CRC, gave a suo motu order, DNA challenged the concept of GST compensation says for change in law in APTEL and dragged us for 2 years. So such non-contestable issues, change in tax, at least, is very simple. If it came after the bid cutoff date, it's a pass-through. Another example comes to my mind. Tangent Po said, look at the PPA. It says all taxes will be paid by the generator. So there is no change in tax covered in change in law. Everything is on generator account. What the PPA merely said is, who pays generator? But it has to be recovered. So if such frivolous arguments can be cut down, the non-contestable change in tax items, if in the tariff policy maybe it says it's payable based on an auditor certificate, but the appropriate authority can determine if there's a dispute regarding the amount payable. But that it is payable should not be a question. Similarly, coal pass-through. Amit is acutely aware he must be fighting tens of cases or 20, 30 cases. It has been 5 years now. The money is still to be seen. Again, it's a change in law. Supreme Court has upheld that it is a change in law. Even then, monies are not coming. If there is a way through tariff policy to give a direction that such non-contestable items are change in law, are payable and based on audit certificate, but if there is any dispute regarding the quantification, it can be referred to authority. So those were the points regarding that speed bucket. I will come to cash flow. We have been trying with the ministry for a long time, but we have not succeeded. Let's say in the MSME Act, there is an order. If any order has to be challenged, 75% of money has to be paid. I am told by my legal colleagues that in the Consumer Dispute Resolution Act also, there is a similar prescription. Any order has to be challenged, 50% has to be paid. So why not we think of, and this is one of the suggestions we associations have given, in Section 111 of the Electricity Act, which gives the power to appeal to APTEL, that any such appeal against an order, 75% of the money has to be paid ad hoc. I think the problem, existential problem that the IPPs face, if that is done, would be significantly addressed, because most money is stuck where regulators have given orders, but it's being challenged in APTEL. If APTEL passes, it's being challenged in Supreme Court. So there are precedences, MSME Act, Consumer Dispute Resolution Act, even for highway projects, you know, that Niti Aayog has given an instruction to NHAI. So in Section 111 of the Electricity Act, why can't this be included that there is 75% has to be deposited? Again, a question I would toss up to Amit to respond, because we thought that will solve the problem. Lastly, we have seen what DISCOMs do is not file their response for 3 months, 6 months, 8 months, and they appeal, and therefore condonation of the delay. And these authorities, I think, since it's a public body coming with that appeal, they allow. In Electricity Act, for appealing against APTEL order to Supreme Court, there is a time limit, 60 days of filing. And Supreme Court, if it's happy that there are reasons substantial, can grant another 60 days. In Electricity Act for appealing to APTEL, it says 45 days, but it can extend beyond, but there is no capping. Let there be a capping of another 45 days. That will also address that there is no dragging by just delaying. I may have put too many points together, but in summarizing, cash flow pressure, if the 75% payment once a regulator is ordered is given, will go a very long way in solving the real problem on the ground, and there are precedences. That's what I would say. Non-contestable items, to take out frivolous contests, if something can be done in tariff policy, that it has to be paid based on audit statutory auditor certificate. If the tariff, if there's a dispute on the quantum that can be challenged, as also the other points regarding capacity creation in APTEL. Contract enforcement authority is a very welcome step. And for simplicity, as I said, any issue with a concluded contract should be under their jurisdiction, tariff or non-tariff related. I think we will get a second chance once others have reflected. So I will rest my case here.
Thank you, Ashish. Welcome, Mr. Sarkar. While you warm up to the session, having heard two on the regulatory side and one from the developer's perspective, let me invite the second member of the developer flock. Vipul Tuli, again, needs no introduction. He chairs the FICCI Power Committee, is the Managing Director of Sembcorp India. And in the yesteryears, which many of you may remember, had a very seminal role in consulting in India for McKinsey on and did a lot of work on the infrastructure side, particularly energy. I would invite Vipul to share his perspective on how he sees the dispute resolution mechanism, having worked under the Act since 2003. The suggested changes and perspectives, and then perhaps we can go to the 75% of the burden, as Dr. Pramod Dev mentioned, which is Supratim's area of concern. Over to you, Vipul.
Thanks, Amit, and welcome, Supratim. Look, I think most of the points that cut to the chase have been very well made by Pramod ji, Rakesh ji, and Ashish as well. So what I will do is, let me just focus my comments on two things. Number one, to give you a sense of how bad the problem is from a developer's perspective. And number two, maybe a few suggestions on what could be up for debate. So I think number one, which is something, you know, we all talk about crisis in the sector and so on, but sometimes I think the quantitative magnitude of what's going on escapes most of us because we are so busy kind of trying to get things done. If we look at the economics of all generators across the sector, I'm talking private sector, public sector, all of them, I just take the generators. You may be shocked to learn that if you take all the private generators, the net return on equity for the last year was minus 5%. If you take all the PSU listed generators, the net return on equity is about 11%, slightly more respectable. And so if you put the two together and take it on a weighted average basis, return on equity is 5.5%. Now, if this is a sector that has to invest to take the country forward, whether in conventional generation or in renewables or later transmission, et cetera, clearly at a 5% return on equity, it's going to be very hard to make the case. And certainly if you look at the private sector side of it, which are where a lot of the risks kind of flow down and reside, at minus 5%, I think the answer as to why nobody is investing further is right there, not very far. So I think it's important for us, whether we are in industry or we are on the legal side or in the regulatory side, to understand the magnitude. On top of this, besides the ROE, this is just the P&L side of it, profit and loss side of it. If you take the liquidity side of it, typically delay in dispute resolution, most of which have liquidity implications, typically I would say 2 to 5 years is a very, very common you know, I don't have any statistics on this, but I think anyone in the sector will agree that 2 to 5 years is a very typical dispute resolution time, which means that one estimate is that there's over 20,000 crores in just dues related disputes, or more than that, and not to talk of any other related disputes which are stuck in this kind of situation. What that really does is there is some visible side of it, which is companies either going bankrupt or cost of debt going up. But there's the risk part of it, which actually we don't get to see as a sector, which is the conversation that happens in the boardrooms and the conversation that happens in sometimes inside India, sometimes outside India, where people simply say, look, the risk is unbearable. It's really not worth it. And for a sector which, if I look at the just the generation side, which has probably something like 6 to 7 lakh crores invested today in the private and PSU sector, not the state sector. If you include the state sector, it's probably 10 to 12 lakh crores. With that kind of capital employed, to have this sort of a risk, it's just we are fundamentally putting the economy at risk. So therefore, to me, the conclusion really is that there are three things that are quite when we look at resolution. One is independence, one is viability, and the other is speed. If I look at the change in law type of disputes, which Ashish mentioned, which are many, many, and we've got issues of speed that come in there, and you can go to almost any generator in the country and several hundred crores will typically be tied up in that. All that is coming out of equity that could be invested in the sector. If you look at our very hot topical issue of FGDs these days, if you look at the payment delays, of which there are many, many cases, if you look at pass-through disputes, you look at renewables contract sanctity disputes, all three factors, independence of regulators comes into play. The view that regulators take on viability comes into play. And if I may be so bold as to say that very often we find more of a issue of please don't force them to pay because they can't pay, rather than saying, look, you've invested 5,000 or 10,000 or 20,000 crores. There is some basic minimum return on equity for viability that's required because you have to keep this. All these three factors come into play. If you take the broader transition into renewables that Rakesh ji also mentioned, we've just about scratched the surface on the complexity and the challenges that renewables are going to bring. And the kind of capacity, capability that will have to be there in the regulators to be able to deal with. These are issues which we can't simply say, look at this country or that country or look at the solutions internally, because these are uncertainties that are playing up. So the amount of time, effort, and thoughtfulness that will be needed is quite important. Where do we come to in terms of suggestions? I would say that to me, the simplest and most fundamental suggestion is the separation of rulemaking and tariff setting from adjudication. It goes back to the basic structure of the Constitution. It goes back to many well-established points of law, including by the Supreme Court, I'm told, where separating adjudication from rulemaking or tariff setting is a fundamental tenet. The only thing I would add to this is that it should be, as I think some of the previous speakers have also said, it should be really all adjudication as opposed to only tariff-related adjudication. The simple reason being, once you have a contract that's operating, it's almost impossible to separate tariff-related, non-tariff-related because of the number of, say, the change in law disputes, the number of pass-through-related disputes, et cetera, et cetera. And so really keep that separation. The benefits of doing that have been very, very well articulated by everyone in terms of freeing up time, creating more capacity, giving more focus, speedier resolution. I think number two, to my mind, having a central body that is actually somewhat more distant from the customers will certainly give more credibility in eyes of the investors. We've seen this to a large extent on the telecom side already. And I think that's an important point. I think number three, we have to be a bit cautious in terms of how we implement or how it gets implemented. In the sense that we shouldn't fall into the trap of trying to solve a problem, but landing up in a bigger problem. So specifically what I'm talking about is ensuring more than enough capacity on the benches. Whether we create multiple regional benches, whether we go ahead and provide adequate budgetary funds, etc., but adequate capacity of the benches to take care of not today's backlog, but tomorrow's volume of cases, which will come. Of course, as was mentioned, I do agree that if there is independence in the adjudication body itself, the volume of cases could perhaps come down very quickly right then. And finally, I just wanted to say that the cost of delay and the payment of outstanding amounts, I couldn't agree more with what Ashish said. Putting money on the table, because the reality is that today, the state of the DISCOMs in most cases, or in many cases, is such that there is genuine difficulty in paying. And so they're looking for all these creative excuses. So forcing the system to create back pressure by saying, you have to put 75% of the money on the table if you want to appeal, and then you keep appeal, yes, keep that money aside, etc. Last and final point, I'd simply say that as we are building up an organization like this, or a bench, or a set of benches, or a tribunal of this kind, part of the capacity building and capability building efforts in there must be around a very deep understanding of the economics of the sector. And I don't mean to say that that understanding doesn't exist today, but what I mean is the judicial understanding and the technical understanding usually is very strong. It should be balanced with an equally strong economic understanding of the sector, which is what is really going on in the, what are the risks? Where does the leakage of profit happen? Where does the additional cost of debt come? Where does the additional sort of liquidity burdens come, etc.? If that can also be built in systematically into this sort of an organization, that would be good. So I'll say.
Thank you, Vipul. And that brings me to the man who carries the mantle to fund, Vipul, Ashish, and the rest of the sector, and often is called in to bail out when the unfundable is also required. So, Dada, Mr. Subratim Sarkar, what are your views on the matter? No, you're on mute. You're on mute.
Sorry. I must
intervene to say he's not known to be mute normally. So it was uncharacteristic. Go ahead.
We heard about the disputed part of the tariffs, you know, where there are some disputes, how do we do, what do we do, capacity building, and set up more benches, okay, like something of that nature. We also heard in case of NCLT, but we, you know, my MS Amit will bear me out that we talked about the number of benches, but we still are struggling, and we have a staggering number of cases which are there. So let us understand that whenever it is undisputed, do we get the payment? If you ask me, when I look at the, as a receiver of ultimate funds back, whatever I have lent to the generators, and when I come back, when I get it, I find many a time, sir, there is some problem with this particular discount. They are saying they could not pay the salary, sir. So maybe next month they will pay, something can be done. I don't know, although there was a formula for working capital calculations, which is to say, I think 2 months of receivables. I will not find a single generator who is actually having only 2 months, because the highest I think, as far as I remember, is 11 months in one case. And the minimum I have come across is 4 to 5 months. I may be wrong, but this is what the case is. Second thing, I think more than the capacity building, more than the disputes, I think there's the intent. You know, it is like a ETC contractor. If I don't pay, I get a sadistic pleasure. A similar analogy is there in the case of DISCOM. Not giving the payment or not passing the payment gives some sadistic pleasure. And it is not only the DISCOM. It is deep rooted. In this term of COVID, you know, I had to go along with one of our senior functionaries to meet Gujarat, the minister and the secretaries and all. This is regarding our recent Gujarat judgment, Gujarat government order, which said that they had a cabinet meeting where the JR that we should not pay up compensatory tariffs for neither for Tata's nor for Adani nor for Essar. And Gujarat was the one who actually initiated the entire process. So you wanted to understand what has gone wrong that you people have, we have taken a 2 steps backward. what we were told that since no other states, because Tatas have, I think, multi-state, five states apart from Gujarat, no other state has moved in any direction, and Punjab has written a letter and followed by two other letters saying that how did you do it, you should not have done it and all. So therefore, we decided not to do it. Now, if that was the case, I think we all spent at least, I remember spending, Dr. Pramod Devasav is also here. I think we spent some 7-8 months in that committee, okay, or 6-7 months in that committee, and then we had late night meetings and all those things, and finally it went to the Supreme Court through the government of Gujarat, went to the Supreme Court, we filed counter affidavits, everything was done. But now, suddenly we have, because we received some letter from Punjab, we believe that no, we should not get into that. Now, so basically, if you ask me that as a banker, we are also now thinking that whether we should fund or not, one. Second thing, there is, some more enlightenment has happened with us, because we also are seeing that if we don't fund power projects, okay, still power, there is no shortage of power. Okay. And the third thing is, there are quite a number of projects which are maybe between 30% and 80% completed. But they are somewhere lying, and some of them are 100% completed also. But they are not functioning, because obviously it has gone either in NCLT or in the process of NCLT or in some other form it is there. Now, if someone takes over, if at all, and even at 1 crore per megawatt or 2 crore per megawatt or 3 crore per megawatt, whatever you must say, at least it will function. But there is no, where is that someone? That someone is missing somewhere. So, one very dispassionate thought process which has come and got sunk into the mind of lenders is, do we fund generators? One. Second thing, do we even fund DISCOMs? Because the 25% after the, the Uday scheme, 25% of the funding can be done by the working capital lenders. Now, still lenders are thinking whether we should do or not. And now, if any of the lenders have lent to the DISCOMs, now that 90,000 crores is being unleashed through the PFC-REC mechanism, but that does impact even the permanent indebtedness of that particular DISCOM. Because even my money, which I have given, which I am supposed to recover from him, will get impaired, because they have to pay the additional interest also because of that particular loan. Now, and no bank was consulted for that. Let me tell you that also. That 90,000 crore formula, which was conceived, not a single lender who is the lender to the DISCOM was consulted. So I think it is more, more than a dispute resolution, I think it should be more to address as the intent to create a dispute. One. Second thing, I still remember there was a meeting which was convened by the Union Secretary of Power. Mr. Bhalla was there that time, those days. And Member Secretary CA was there. And in that discussion, one thing was very clear. I think someone raised, I think people raised the topic of, I think, FGD. And someone raised in the topic of that, the fuel, imported fuel for that 70-30 formula, CCA thing to be passed through and all. And it was said within 3 months we'll do. Because many of us have seen that 3 months, but nothing has happened. So my sense is, I think, ultimately, if the CERC or the APTEL, they pass on something, but still we have seen there is a huge tendency of the DISCOMs to go to a higher court, appellate authority, which means the Supreme Court. It's like the NHAI and the contractor. First, arbitration, after arbitration, High Court, after the High Court, Supreme Court. So unless Supreme Court finally comes out with, I think, some kind of a direction which allows that beyond this point, you should not move ahead, because the cases will keep on piling and getting admitted. So, you know, as a lender group, we are pretty, I would say, after what has happened to the recent Gujarat action, which has put us, a real thought process that whether we should at all fund any of these or wait for some other entities to fund it. And also, there is a question which is being asked now that we are also large lenders to PFC REC, which has huge exposure to these JMOs. Now, how do we move on with that? How do they take care of this? So I rest my thoughts right now.
Thank you, Dada. You have not answered. You have put more questions on our head. So how do we help you open your purse strings to release funds for the sector and the economy is the challenge. Since I did not introduce him earlier, and I'd rather that you had heard him, this is Subhadip Sarkar, for those who don't know, is Executive Vice President and has been leading the whole structured finance initiative. So it's quite daunting to hear from somebody like that, one of the few voices in the country who understood project financing and actually rooted for it, to say we are now going to only do corporate financing to the DISCOM or the generator. And that will be definitely a higher burden in the infrastructure pipeline being realized. May I, at this juncture, invite Mr. Sanjay Malhotra to share any perspective that he may have, so that if there are any things that have come up in his hearing of what we have said and the reflections of what is being heard on the bill, he could perhaps seed some points for us to debate in the second round, because it will be useful to then see what we have to say and then hear him at the end. Mr. Sanjay Malhotra is Additional Secretary PAR.
Thank you, Amit, and thank you to Fiki for giving me this opportunity. The leading lights, of the power sector are here, and it's been really very enriching and enlightening hearing all of you. I had thought that I'll, reserve my comments and response for the end, but if you feel like, if you feel this is going to be a better way, I have no hesitation. I mean, I'll go ahead.
We can keep it for the end. If there are any, I was only saying, if there are any issues that have emerged on the consultation on the bill, particularly on the dispute resolution, that we have not covered, which you want to indicate, because then we like to focus the deliberations on the four or five points that we watched. And at the end, we would like you to give our
I think you have, I think all the points, to my knowledge, insofar as the dispute resolution mechanism is concerned, are covered.
So I was only asking for that. We would like to have you hear everything and then give us your perspective and get into the Q&A, because there are people in the audience who understand the sector, have experienced it. So having heard everybody, I think there's a large consensus around the need for the dispute resolution authority, whichever that be. There is a large coalition around the fact that it has to be timely, speedy, and effective in terms of implementation. And if that's correct, then may I start in the reverse order? And not, of course, not back with Supratim, but I'll first get to Vipul and Ashish, and then come to Supratim, and then go back to those who are used to ruling at the end after hearing everybody. That is Mr. Pramod Dev at the first instance, and Mr. Rakesh Nath at the appellate level. And then we'll come to the policymaker so that he can enact the law to solve the problem. So may I request Vipul, in context of what we've heard from all of us, and particularly the concerns that have been shared by Supreme, because the big concern that we have is that ultimately creditworthiness of the sector was the start point of Electricity Act 2003. It was at the back of the Monte Singh Ahluwalia Committee's bailout package of 42,000 odd crores, which were owed to CPSEs. Today, we are looking at a number which is nearly 10 times that. So I don't know whether we are delighted by the fact that our IPP capacity is 47% and in the RE, it's over 80%, or we are troubled by the fact that our gaping hole has gone 10 times larger, because ultimately we are pushing more water through a wider hole in the bucket. And in that context, our ambition to take India to the next level, where RE really becomes a serious contender in the grid, the whole market development, where there's a need for a new ancillary market mechanism, the whole power market scenario on the immediate and the derivatives, and therefore the incentive structures of growing this into a very different, a very vibrant market where there is a level playing field for people to come, compete, and work efficiently, is going to be denied, because the burden that the Indian industry carries today as a consumer of what the generators produce and the DISCOM supply is at the back of the fact that we are not able to participate in our bilateral and multilateral forums like RCEP. We find it difficult to go and compete when the 60 to 70% cost of iron and rolling mills is basic electricity, and they are loaded with 2 rupees, 3 rupees, 4 rupees per unit as cross subsidy and subsidy surcharges, which is basically a euphemism to try and lump all the shortfalls that we have in the shortfall in tariff, and then the pending disputes on the cost of time value of money. So, Vipul, you go first, and then I'd request Ashish to come in, and then we can get to deciding.
I think, Amit, look, at least the last 30-odd years that I've had the privilege of being in and out of the sector, I've rarely seen a sector with so much intellectual horsepower and so many discussions and so many conferences and so many ideas and so many attempts at fixing the problem. So maybe the most over-conferenced sector I've seen in a while. But it, to my mind, this issue of creditworthiness comes down to three very simple and very core issues. First, are we truly expecting to build a world-class, world-competitive economy on the basis of not paying for energy? And I think that's a fundamental question which gets down to the polity. It's a political question, less than an economic question. The economic answer is very obvious, but the political answer is not that obvious. And so in that sense, I do think that resolving that issue, and I don't want to speak out of school here, but the reality is that we may have a better chance today than in many years to actually resolve that political issue, which is we cannot build an economy when the energy sector underneath it is bankrupt. We can pay for everything else, but this is one of the last few remaining commodities if you look at our purchase basket of an average family, where when it comes to power, there suddenly everyone wants to. That's the first issue. Second issue is, Supratim touched upon it, but I do want to sort of actually disagree with him, which is the question, from a banker's perspective, I can understand where he's coming from, but I still want to disagree with him, which is that where is the shortage of power? So if I don't fund, where's the compelling need to fund something right now? And obviously from a banker's perspective, that's a very fair this thing. But if you look at it from a power sector perspective, the average planning to commissioning cycle for a new conventional plant is 7 years from planning to commissioning. If you take the average development time, that itself is 5 years. Average construction time, if you're very fast and don't get into any major issues, maybe 3 to 4 years. If you take renewables, which is faster but comes with its own issues, even that time has now got elongated. On average, we're talking of about 3+ years, maybe more. So if we want to hit a target that's 5 to 7 years out, we have to find a way to fund now. And I think there have been attempts to try and say, okay, let's, you know, put PPAs on the table, let's ensure long-term funding, etc. And of course, the central PSUs and some of the state GenCos have played a fabulous role to make sure that that investment cycle continues. But as far as the private sector is concerned and the lenders are concerned, both of whom are driven by commercial considerations, I think they've pretty much voted with their feet. And so the question really is, if we are in an apparent surplus today, heading for a very strong shortage, how do we make sure we have viability for future investments? Investment viability, not ke bhaiya aapko 5% ROE mil raha hai, toh theek hai na, kya complain kar. That's the second issue. Third issue, I would say, is it gets to your point about renewables, which is recognizing the true cost of power. And I've seen some excellent work by some of our state regulators on this topic, but that's few and far between. The reality is that while we are all highly focused on, you know, how do we get that 3 rupee bus bar tariff down to 240 or 250 or 270, etc., the true costs of volatility, the cost of transmission, etc., are very substantial. And we can do the maths in many different ways. Either way, you will come to somewhere between five or six rupees at a minimum, if not more. And we simply on this topic have to look at other countries who have got large penetration of renewables to see there are very substantial costs of volatility, of transmission, of offshore power, of separately for the grid, separately for conventional power. And all those add up to power costs, which even on a PPP basis are typically three times what our power tariffs are. And so the only point I'm trying to make is that unless as a sector we recognize the true cost of power and then either find a way to say, look, here's how I'll pay for it, or I want you to pick up the risk and pay for it, or I want you five guys to compete to make that cost down. All of those are legitimate. But given the size of investment we require, it's not going to be a very viable way forward to disguise that true cost of power. Similar thing, I think, in some form or shape is playing out again on the FGD issue, if I may be quite blunt, where, you know, it's a matter of net-net. Everyone knows somewhere between 20 to 50 paisa per unit cost will go up depending on what the FGD is and where you are and so on and so forth. Because we don't want to solve the political issue, we end up delaying the commercial issue, which then lands up with our banker friend saying, why should I fund? Fair enough.
Thanks, Vipul. May I turn to Ashish to get his perspective on how he sees the situation and the way forward?
Yeah, I think Supratim mentioned is the issue of intent and where is the cash even after orders are received. A very fair point that he mentioned about the sadistic pleasure. Here, both the lender and the investor, we have the same perception as we see how some of the DISCOMs are behaving. I think in this Electricity Amendment Act, an honest attempt has been made. Of course, we have to see, being a concurrent subject, how far it can be carried through. I think the direct benefit transfer which has been proposed. So in the name of subsidy, a lot of inefficiency are packed in. That's our understanding. Again, there are unguided subsidy where the undeserving get it. So a direct benefit transfer, which like LPG is being proposed here, I think that it if can be implemented today is a big solid step to address the long-term viability of the sector. After all, in this family, there is only one guy which earns the bread, which is the DISCOMs. The rest provide goods to supply. So the DISCOMs have to be viable. So direct benefit transfer, which takes away the issue of cross subsidy, etc., for DISCOMs, it can charge commercial tariff to everybody. That will unclutter and improve viability, number one. As Vipul said, unfortunately, electricity is still a political good, not an economic good. To that extent, there is some attempt made. Privatization of distribution has been very political. In addition to franchises, there is a concept of sublicensees, which I guess, though the Act does not provide the detail, it would mean they will have a much longer term, would be legally placed in a better turf, on a better turf than franchisees. So bringing in private sector efficiency and accountability in the distribution sector is a key, without which this entire sector will be in trouble. So direct benefit transfer and through the sublicensee route, government has also said it will start the union territories to be privatized first, take a jab at some of the big DISCOMs of the state. Those are very critical moves. I think the intent of MOP is right, government is right. We, from the lender side, investor side, regulators, we should all push to support that. I think the long-term sustainability, the attempt has been made in this act. I fully endorse and lenders, and we think alike, because our money stuck is lenders' money stuck. That's why we suggested once there is an order, like many other precedences which I mentioned, any challenge has to be preceded by a 75% payment. Otherwise, that appeal will not be entertained. If that is put in, frivolous appeal will go away. We would not be providing funding to DISCOMs which will have no urge to get their house in order. And doing teaming and lading, they will continue to run their business. I think these are the two points I wanted to make. Thirdly, one point, another which comes, again, we are seeing now that CRC gives orders, nobody complies with it. Some DISCOMs are smart enough not to even challenge, because CRC has no teeth in implementation. In this Electricity Amendment Act, Section 121, there is a proposal that APTEL is given powers of High Court to enforce their judgments. We would suggest that APTEL has the power to enforce not only their judgment if they wish and find it suitable, to enforce compliance of ERC and contract enforcement regulatory judgment also. This is already enshrined in the Act architecture, as I understand, that High Court can enforce decisions of lower court for compliance. So APTEL should be given that power. It's a proposal. It should be further strengthened, not only their judgment, but they can enforce the judgment of ERCs and contract enforcement authority. So yes, let's address the intent. The Electricity Act makes an attempt. We should push politically through all our forums that direct benefit transfer, bringing in private sector efficiency, be it through sub-licensee, whose role has to be fleshed out in the Act. Currently, it's not there. And upfront payment, once an order is there, 75%. Besides the other points, I would not like to repeat. I think these two will go a long way in improving things.
Thank you. So I think the lender normally doesn't come before the regulator and the tribunal. So this one we should put him before so that you can give a perspective. I have been always a little concerned that with 70 to 80% of the financing being in the hands of the lender, who is a trustee of the deposit holders like you and me, somehow the lender is diffident in coming to courts and public forums and raising the issue, which ultimately is leading to the impairment. And being good boys with the government in the middle, they have often suffered both sides. So, Dada, how do you think that will change and what can we do to restore the credibility? You have identified the fact that from 2 months working capital, we are looking at 11 months. And if we continue slipping, it can go 2 years. And that will be the end of the story. So how do we make sure that the bulbs are more and we are not going back to candles?
See, I think the attempt which is being made for, Ashish just said, that DBT, the privatization, bringing in franchisee, wherever you cannot do at least privatization, but franchising the right model of franchisee, like Rajasthan has done a good job, if you ask me on the franchisee, but I don't think our, except Bhiwandi, Maharashtra has done a very good job in, those two other places, Nagpur and one more, Aurangabad, I think. They didn't do very well. My sense is, I think, two things. If you go to a DISCOM, now, when we were doing this HPC, Mr. Malhotra also will bear me out, and even Dr. Pramod Dev, sir. One of the things which came out was, we are not taking power, but the DISCOM has to pay a fixed capacity charge because it's a name generation, and I think in case of Maharashtra, it is as high as 6,000 or 7,000 crores they pay. Now, there was an attempt at some point of time that, you know, the old plants will be shifted away or it will be closed and the new plants will come, which are much more efficient, and it will move ahead. But I think somewhere, I don't know, we got, shelved, or the process is very slow. It is as good as shelved. Okay. Second thing is contract enforcement authority. Can it be challenged in the Supreme Court? Suppose it has given something. Now, therefore, everything boils down to, normally we have seen in most of these contractual cases, especially in the roads and highway sector, in the energy sector, it goes ultimately into the Supreme Court. So that if it goes, then if it can be only ensured that it doesn't go anywhere beyond the contract enforcement authority, maybe it goes up to APTEL beyond that. Okay, and that's it. You can't go. At least it solves a number of cases. And I'm not sure that if we can actually look at that 75%, what was being suggested by Ashish, because I can tell you cases in with NHAI or any other contracting companies, wherein banks are saying, I'll pay you, give you 75% bank guarantee, release by cash. That itself is not being done. And it is not only the NHAI, but also the CPSUs, some of the CPSUs operating in the power sector. Okay. In fact, today only we had one case. In fact, I was in one of those meetings, okay, requesting Damodar Valley Corporation for something, and it was being contested. So anyway, so my point is, if we can ensure that number of benches are more, one. Second thing, what is the whether a person or a DISCOM can go ahead and again dispute in the Supreme Court beyond the contract enforcement authority, then it will be one more CERC kind of a thing which is there. Because ultimately everything has to be decided, looks like, in Supreme Court. So somewhere in principle, judgment needs to be brought in place in Supreme Court, which will say these issues, which are related to FGD, which are related to CCEA, that imported coal and this, these all can be put in rest. So that no point in fighting, because if you, someone was saying about the number of cases. So I think quite a number of cases are in this category. And FGD today, one of the reasons why we are not funding, because unless you show me in principle clearance from the regulator that yes, this will be passed in the order, we are very clear, we will not fund. So that's, I think, is the one thing which has to be also looked at. But I still hold my comment, people, I'm sorry, but I hold my comment even today that I'm not sure that we require immediately some base load capacities, because I don't see the base load capacity increasing, because whatever is happening is mostly will be happening in the renewable sector, which can take at least us till 2024-25. Okay, unless we, and by that time I hope at least next 2 years we should try to see some better operations in the sector, in the better behavioral pattern of the sector, which would help the lenders, the investors, everyone to come back into the sector and see that we can invest some more. That's it.
Amit, no. With your permission, I wanted to take just 1 minute.
Sure, please.
Okay. One point is, this is a very critical thing, 75%. I quoted MSME Act and Consumer Forum. You have to give your input, because that's where a lot of problem solving lies, A. Number two, for FGD, Mr. Sarkar, what we have done, and CRC has acknowledged that without a certainty that this is a change in law, as also a provisional tariff, so that I do not toil for another 4 years before I see some cash, CRC has acknowledged these 2 points. In a Sasan case judgment, if I am not wrong, it has recognized that the lenders need that certainty. We had a discussion through MOP last week, CERC is coming out with a staff consultation paper where we have said, you give me a provisional tariff which I get from the first day. The FGD becomes operational. Otherwise, no lender is going to get money. MOP has kindly convened that meeting where banks had come, CERC had come. And this is the path we are walking for FGD. Otherwise, such a huge fund requirement, we will not be able to mobilize. That's number one. Thirdly, just one more point Vipul mentioned. We wholeheartedly endorse this true cost of power because, as we all know, renewable were being handheld and their transmission costs were kept zero. It means the rest are bearing the cross. Now, renewable has crossed the average cost of power in the market. It's now not only walking on its own two legs, it's running. There is no point to give it a handicap. That's one. Besides other points which Vipul said, capacity must be idling to pick up their load. So there should be a true realization of true cost of power so that we are not running after headlines, but making sure first the available capacity in the country is fully utilized. Otherwise, we are bringing fresh investments into that black hole again.
Correct.
I will stop there.
Thank you. So now can I move on to Dr. Pramod Dev? So where do you see this going, sir? What is your thought on all the discussions that we've had around the sectoral realities in the future? You're on mute, Dr. Dev. You're on mute. We can't hear you. You're still on mute. So you have to unmute yourself. Your screen is showing mute.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, sure. No, I think if we go back to 15 years and see that we are in the same situation as we were, because the problem really remains is the political. Because when we talk about DISCOMs, DISCOMs and the state governments are no different. Because all the DISCOMs are the state government's creature. And it is the state government which has their political agenda, and that has to be fulfilled through DISCOM. So all these suggestions are very welcome and they are necessary for the viability. That like 75% must be deposited. There should be no delay in payment. If you have this authority, its orders must be enforced. And this myth that we keep talking about, that we are power surplus, forget about the COVID. Because before that also, like I moved to this Alibag area 17th of March, anticipating this lockdown. And there are many people from Mumbai who have already done that, those who had their second homes. You have got the Ruyas, Ajit Gulab Chand, Tawlin Singh. They all are spending these last 4 months here. And if you see the power supply situation, forget about the Nisarg cyclone, which completely destroyed the DISCOM system. But what is the power supply here situation? And this is Maharashtra, which is supposed to be having no load shedding. But if you see, ask me the reality, so obviously when we talk about the gap between demand and supply, that is a completely different matter. Because the reason is that DISCOM can want to supply only to the paying consumer. And there is a huge burden of agriculture, which has to be carried. So if you talk of the viability of the power sector, it really depends upon what the political decision is taken, how to meet this cross-subsidy burden. Otherwise, we can put in the amendment number of things which will not get implemented. So this is really the issue, because the RE power, whether it should be not given any further concession, is something which is a matter of debate. But the reality is that RE power has to be encouraged, and there are a number of good reasons for that. But we again come back to the issue of this enforcement authority. If we have a self-reference authority, it is going to help. That's why I am supporting that. But I am aware that this is not the solution. The real solution lies in the political domain, which only the Prime Minister and Chief Minister, they had to sort out. Because the Take the case of Maharashtra, which is supposed to have a separate agriculture feeder. But now, this time, very good exercise was done by NERC because Prayas got involved. Now, Maharashtra has been claiming that their distribution losses have come down to 16%. But when this tariff order was passed, their distribution losses are 21%. So all this jugglery of figures has been done. It is the agriculture consumption which has been inflated, and they have been now asked to reduce it to, otherwise they were very close to the national goal of 15%, but that is not the reality. So that being the case, we have to face the issue that how are we going to do, because the privatization of DISCOM is something which is, I don't think any chief minister will be willing to do that. At the most, you can go for a franchisee. That also they would like to give it areas which are difficult to handle. They would not like to give a franchisee or give a sub-distribution license to paying area. Like if you were to take like Pune city, obviously this is the one which cross-subsidizes. So this is the big burden of cross-subsidy the sector is carrying. So let us face it, because when we say that we want to bring in more efficiency by inviting private sector in the distribution, I think the real mistake has been we have invited private sector in big way in generation and also transmission to some extent. But the real basis is finally comes to this DISCOM. So even if you were to make it mandatory that 75% has to be paid, where is the money? DISCOM doesn't have the money for the payment. Because you can clearly see that after the cyclone, they don't have money to restore the system. It is more than a month that work is still going on because the contractors are not being paid. If they have erected the poles, there is no money to pay to the contractor for stringing wires. So that is the financial state of MSEDCL, which is one of the better DISCOMs, you can say. So let us again have to go back when we talk of all these amendments, that these are the basic issues which need to be addressed. As far as this contract enforcement authority, yes, there is a need for that. But whether it will be have the efficiency which is demanded, that is doubtful. That's what I will say. The basic question remains the viability of DISCOM and the political nexus between state government and the DISCOM. They are not two different entities. They are one and the same.
Thank you, sir. And finally, to the appellate authority, because we will allow no Supreme Court here. So what do you think, Dr. Viswanath?
Yeah, I think for me, number one priority is the distribution reform, because I feel poor financial health of the distribution licensees is one of the major reasons for in piling up of the cases in commissions and in tribunal. In my tenure in tribunal, I found a large number of cases where state commission has given a very reasoned order. The utilities have just challenged it, just to gain time to. And unless the financial health of the distribution companies improve, whatever orders we may get, interim order for payment of 70%, 75% of the disputed amount, but they will make payment as per the APTEL order, interim order, but then not pay current charges for some other generator. Because when the kitty is limited, they will cut from somewhere and give it to. So the solution lies in the improving the health of the distribution companies. And I personally feel that by now we should be having at least one third of the state in each state in the private sector, at least one third. But as Dr. Pramod Dev says, privatization is very difficult. I think the sub-licensee is a very good move which has been proposed in the present act, because it will give more certainty. And the problems that a franchisee faces, I think, can be overcome by the sub-licensee route. Only thing is that the functions, obligations of the sub-licensee have to be very clearly defined in the act. There have to be some rules to be framed by central government defining how this sublicensee will operate. As far as the cross-subsidy is concerned, I think one thing I'm very sure that cross-subsidy should not be cost of the utilities or generating company. Some cross-subsidies, the subsidizing consumers, the paying consumers will have to pay. That is inevitable. We can't get rid of it. And the act also, the intent of the parliament is that some part of it has to be subsidized by the paying consumers, the what you call the industries and commercial. But it should be within the limit specified in the policy, so that the industry and the commercial establishments also survive and they also become competitive. As far as the enforcement of the tribunal order is concerned, I think they already have a power of civil court. The problem lies in the enforcement of the order of the state commission, because they don't have any such powers. The proposed enforcement authority, I think, has been given the power of civil court to enforce its orders, which is a good thing. Tribunal already had it. A tribunal is additionally being proposed to be given the power of contempt, which is, I think, is a good move. It may be required in exceptional cases, because I remember in one commission, I don't want to name the commission, but where APTEL gave repeated judgments and which were not implemented by giving some excuse or the other. And when we asked the commission to appear before us, we never wanted an open court hearing. We only wanted a chamber hearing. The commission got a stay order from the Supreme Court. So then that did not see at the light of the day. So these are the difficulties in implementation orders, because I think which are being taken care of in the proposed amendment.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So another, this, sir.
One please. More issue is not only in the cutting the AT&C losses, etc. I think other efficiency like power procurement cost, I think there is still a lot of scope in reducing the power procurement cost. The states are following merit order, but I don't think that is being followed very religiously. For example, the state units are not going below 70% cost. 70% of the full load, whereas the Central Commission regulation says for 55% for technical minimum. I think still a lot of scope, and also we have to look at the way merit order is being decided. But there are also different methods being used for drawing up the merit order. So there, I think, is a little more scope in improving the cost of the power.
Thank you, sir. Now, with this round, what I would do, while I will try and cull together the thoughts that have come so that we can then invite Mr. Sanjay Malhotra to share his views on it. We have also a secret weapon with us. Mr. Prabir Nayogi is known to all of us for long years. He is the mentor and the guide of the Power Committee today. He chaired that committee for long years. And I can't help but pull him in, because I'm sure he must be, he's the other Dada in the team, besides the two Bhishma Pitamahas, Dr. Pramod Dev and Rakesh Nath, and Supratim, the other Dada, who must share his views and his perspectives on what has gone on, including if any questions arise, because I'm sure he has something very valuable to contribute on these issues that we've discussed. Over to you.
Thank you, Amit. And you know, it's a couple of quick points I wanted to make to the panelists and take the benefit of their presence. And it's something I wanted to pose to you, Amit, as well. One is, you see, the view that's emerging is that we should have the legislative and adjudicative powers separated to make both the commission and the empowered body effective. If not, you know, speed act speedier, right? Now, we do have a choice, right? You know, in terms of 79.1F, section 79.1F and 86.1F. Now, basically, the commissions can either adjudicate disputes or refer them to arbitration. So the choice is between arbitration and adjudication. So which course should we follow? Now, in terms of Section 158, the commission also has a choice of nominating the arbitrator. Or, you know, we can follow the Arbitration and Conciliation Act. Now that, you know, we are trying to separate the legislative powers from adjudicative powers, so which is a course, you know, you think, or the panelists would think we should follow, is should it be arbitration as a more effective way of resolving disputes? Should it be a separate adjudication together? Or should we have the regulatory commissions totally divested of all adjudicative powers and concentrating and emphasizing on their rulemaking authority? That's one. Two is, in terms of the ECA, the way it has been proposed, see, there is a subtle difference in the sense that 79(1)(f) and 86(1)(f) would normally refer to disputes between generating companies and licenses or between licenses. Whereas a new contract enforcement authority refers to performance obligations under contract for sale, purchase, and transmission. Now, would this body also cover disputes under open access regime and under net metering regulations? Because, you know, these are the new dimensions that are emerging. And my third point is, I think there is a disconnect because the statement of objects and reasons would refer the body as an electricity tribunal. So is it basically the tribunalization path we are looking at, or is it basically the body being empowered with civil court orders, civil court powers? So these are the, you know, three quick points I wanted to make, and among the panelists and between you, if you would like to respond.
Sure. So if anybody wants to respond from the panel, I would then pull things together and propose for Mr. Malhotra.
On the first point, this is, if I may respond, arbitration we have seen is a very costly exercise, provider, and the timelines are 18 months. So I think instead of arbitrating, giving it to a separate adjudication authority, both in terms of cost and time, I am hoping would be much more efficient. That's one. On the second part, that's a good point, Amit, we'll have to reflect. But in our proposal, we have said not only contract between generators and licensees, or supply providers and licensees, but also between two licensees. So wherever contracts are involved, this should be the adjudicating authority. Arbitration provision, logically, if it's a contract, adjudication is given to enforcement, contract enforcement authority, power to refer to arbitrator should be given to them and not to CERC anymore, because arbitration is typically within the confines of a contract to arbitrate on a dispute. But arbitration, we find, is whatever we have been exposed to, I have been exposed to, is very costly, running into crores, many crores, and timeline, because good arbitrators are not so many, because they are already involved in a lot of civil arbitration, timeline will also be longer.
Ashish, on the second point, my limited view was that, you know, how do we cover the disputes not only between licenses, but between licensee and, let's say, an open access consumer, or between a licensee and, let's say, a consumer who's covered by net metering and who becomes a presumer?
So, to the extent electricity...
It's basically from a DISCOM perspective, you know, maybe, you know, are we keeping that space covered or not?
If it is covered under the Electricity Act, then it should be going to the adjudicating authority. If it's not, it's a contractual dispute under other courts. But Amit, this is your area.
Yeah, I'm more in favor of referring all disputes to this independent judicial authority. And I would not suggest this arbitration and conciliation route, because then again you are going firstly through a lengthy proceedings, and then you are again landing up in the High Court, because the orders of the under the arbitration act
very correct,
challenged only in the High Court. So then you are bypassing tribunal and a special body which has been created for resolving the disputes relating to electricity. On the open access, I think most of the issues are relating to open access not being granted as per the regulations. And I think these types of things can be settled down by the commission itself. I don't think there is any other issue, major issues in open access, except grant of open access, where distribution company has delayed it or not granting open access.
Thank you, sir. So answering your question, Dada, first and foremost, I think the reason why arbitration, what Ashish mentioned, is right now suffering in India is because these are ad hoc arbitrations. We don't have institutional arbitrations. Ad hoc arbitrations, inherently, at every time there is a dispute, you have to create a new institution which will develop its own rules and then functions on that basis, right from getting the room to the secretarial support to everything else. Then you don't know who will be chosen and how they will get chosen. That's between the parties, and at times you can get into a raft of issues that can delay. The time value of money, as now recognized in the IBC, in fact, financial debt now finally, after long decades of debates, has been accepted by the National Legislation on Bankruptcy Code. The debt and the cost of debt is actually predicated on time value of money. If that's correct, what you need is decisions which are in 2 months and 3 months. 18 months is beyond the 11 months that Supratim was talking about. And I don't think the power sector can afford to carry 1 lakh crores and 2 lakh crores here and there. Let's not forget that at the substratum lies the fact that when the DISCOMs on an aggregate owed 1 lakh crores of current dues to various generators, the DISCOMs are owed 1,75,000 crores by various state-owned enterprises and corporate entities which were in the public domain. And that is the spread of the virus or the gangrene, which is eating up the core of the sector. That is why you have the NPAs which are running into 4 lakh crores. So what you need is quick expert adjudication and a standing authority with a normal registry, a secretariat assistance will be a far better mechanism to work with personally. Secondly, on the issue that you raised about the open access regime and net metering, now that we're defining the law, all of this, including all the other segments and players, including the pool and the exchange, can be covered. Right now, it's just a will. And the whole point of this consultation is to try and concentrate that it was advisedly that we thought that the topic will not be ECEA. The topic of the discussion today, and to pull the experiences and the learnings of all around the table who have spoken and who will be intervening, including Mr. Malhotra, is to try and put our joint thinking together in the interests of the sector and the future of the economy. What is the most efficacious way of solving the problem of dispute resolution to take away the incentive where delays can be an adverse benefit derived by people? Not because they're trying to derive, but because they're short. Now, if we don't fix the basic problem of creditworthiness and viability of the tariff, idle capacity, optimizing our assets, ensuring proper investments. If we do all of that, we'll be at a different state. Today, you have around 40% of your installed capacity of generation idle. You have 80%, 90% of your transmission capacity idle. That's not a great way of working. If that's how we are going to work, then you're bound to have problems in terms of capacity constraints. So I think at the core lies the structural reform of the sector, and perhaps a redefined role, something which we didn't mention, but I'm pointing now, given that Mr. Rakesh Nath is here with us, a redefined role where the CEA, as a national planning body, genuinely takes a proactive role in shepherding the installation of capacities, a point that was made a short while back, that for the next 2 to 3 years, we should not go ahead and install more baseload. We should allow the RE and the growth right now to optimize. And then when there is demand, we go ahead and install more. Because as we carry on building up capacity, while our installed capacity today is working at 50% and 40% PLF, it's a complete crying shame. 50-55% of average PLF at the national level is terrible. So under the circumstances, that's how I would see it. But now let me pull back, and we would love to use the time with Mr. Malhotra. He has heard all of us. We have debated things out. Sir, at the core of the issue, and I would not mount the issues too far, but I would just bring them to your attention. Looking at the efficacy of dispute resolution and focusing on the fact that the ECA as proposed does create a difficulty in terms of overlap of jurisdiction, because there is hardly going to be ever going to be a dispute in contracts. And contracts are PPS, for example, where there will not be a tariff implication. The moment there is a finding that somebody has defaulted, the solution is compensation. Compensation leads to tariff. So then we'll fall into the trap of, now, is there forum shopping available? Should the person who feels that he can, because he's a state-owned enterprise, run to the regulator who's a state regulator and hijack the agenda? Or should I go to, as a private sector, would I prefer to go to the statutory authority? That is one issue which is going to be a problem. The second area is that, given that we all recognize that time value of money and the stranded investment, and the fact that today, as against the norm of tariff, which was 2 months of working capital, in several places reduced to 45 days, we are living with a reality of 10 to 11 months, maybe 9 months as an average, a national average of working capital. So therefore, we are inherently living in a bleeding scenario, and that doesn't invoke confidence unless we are able to work on the other mechanisms of efficiency. And the third big issue which comes, how do we strengthen the hands of the institutions which are going to decide, so that once any decision is taken, the cash flow comes, whether it is 75% deposit or otherwise. The fact of the matter is, if the DISCOM has no money, it is bound not to pay. Can we look at bringing some strength there, along with the fact that you could extend the whole idea of the tripartite agreement even for these? Because ultimately, every generation, every unit of electricity that is generated and supplied is an input cost to the economy. And unless it is just a consumption, wherever it goes into industrial, commercial, or agricultural load, it is bound to be utilized for industrial, commercial employment activities, which is again for the benefit of the economy. So therefore, keeping these in mind, and I'm sure the consultations of the states have been vibrant. I believe that the ministry has received humongous amount of responses. Over 500, 600 comments have come on the proposed bill. How do you see the situation, sir, as you have heard from very, very experienced people with their respective experiences and perspectives? What is your view on where we stand? And then perhaps after your comments, we can open it for Q&A. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Amit and Fiki. I think the presentations, the suggestions that have come, and the ideas that have come forth, they will really be very helpful to the ministry in formalizing its views. So the draft that we circulated, of course, it did contain, you know, our suggestive proposals, but it was basically, you know, food for thought. And I'm very happy to note, first of all, that all of you did agree and acknowledge the fact that there is certainly a need for having a separate authority for dispute resolution, because one of the views that we were having when we formulated this authority was whether we could try and have the dispute resolution mechanism within the CERC, because CERC and the SERCs, because of the fact that it has evolved over a period of time, and maybe there is some advantage, you know, of continuity. But I'm pleased, I'm happy to note that there is certainly some support, there is unanimous support, in fact, for the need, as well as the mechanism that we have proposed for a dispute resolution. I may over here clarify that the disputes that we envisaged were primarily the disputes between generating companies, licensees on one hand, and similarly, the generating companies and transmission companies and the transmission licenses on the other hand. So two kinds of disputes is what, you know, we had envisaged. We if you read the proposed amendment, it does not talk about disputes between consumers, open access. And in fact, I would say that perhaps they are not disputes, they are grievances. Perhaps one can qualify, one can categorize them as grievances arising out of services to be provided by the distribution companies. And the other reason for keeping them out of this particular authority is also that we don't want to overburden it. And so that, you know, it doesn't lose the focus. The point that was made that, you know, there is some overlap is, we spend a lot of time actually trying to resolve this because the Act actually talks about tariff determination by the commissions. And any dispute invariably, you know, will involve some tariff determination, whether it is relating to a generating company or whether it is relating to a transmission company, because now we have, you know, a few private companies also on the transmission side. And so we have kept tariff related disputes out. So now, you know, as has been pointed out, if we keep tariff related disputes out, then the number of disputes that actually come down to the authority is a trickle, because there are very few disputes which do not involve a tariff determination. So we are aware of this issue. This has been raised by you. The solution being suggested here is that all disputes can perhaps be transferred and then to the authority, and then the final determination on the basis of the principles that have been adjudicated upon by the authority can be done by the appropriate commission. So we are aware of that, and that is one formulation that we are also working on, and we'll certainly keep, you know, your suggestions in mind while finalizing the role of this proposed authority. You would have noticed that, you know, the authority, it can have, you know, benches. So hopefully the number of judges or members on the authority should not be a constraint in expeditious disposal of the cases that come to this particular authority. However, I would like to just point out that while the authority may give more, first of all, it will be an independent authority, you know, so it will be acknowledged and recognized as an independent authority, as some of you have said. But whether this will lead to less disputes, as has been pointed out, you know, that is certainly a big question. We'll have to work on it. I mean, the disputes are going to remain. And a lot of questions, a lot of comments have been given on, you know, the litigious tendency of the DISCOMs. I may add, you know, that why this is basically coming is because of five reasons. One is capacity. And so, you know, one talked about capacity building of the authority and of the institutions of the ERC, some of the ERCs. At the same time, you know, there is also a need for capacity building of the DISCOMs. So people in the DISCOMs are actually not sure whether, you know, the change in law asked for is correct and it should be allowed. So only because of ignorance, matters are raised as a dispute. Secondly, there is a fear. Even if it may be right and, you know, the person dealing with the matter feels that, no, this is something which should be allowed, there is a fear. There is a fear of the three C's. Well, why not, you know, put it in the ball of the ERC? Another thing mentioned is, where is the money? The fourth is hope. Well, I feel, yes, this is right. This should be paid. I don't think, you know, there is any CBI related thing or, you know, I mean, I'm not going to be questioned for this. I have the money also. But one doesn't know, we may get a favorable order. And this is true for both sides, let me tell you. It is not one-sided. So because of all these reasons, even if we have a separate authority, number of cases coming down, we'll need to work on it. We'll need to work on, you know, other than just having the authority, we'll also have to work on, you know, all these areas so as to improve our governances, our capacities, our other, you know, the what has been pointed out, I was very happy to note. In fact, I was initially, I was a little surprised also that why this particular topic? I thought, you know, a bigger topic for discussion was, should have been, and which came about, is the solvency, because the root cause of the problem is money. And disputes, see, we would have realized even in our day-to-day functioning, disputes with contractors, disputes with shopkeepers, this, you know, arise only, you know, when there is a constraint of money. When there is a problem, when there is a crisis, then, you know, there are more disputes. And so unless we are able to fix that, and this Electricity Act amendment, you would have noted, tries, makes an attempt to look at some of the issues as to what ails the distribution companies. So one thing that was pointed out was tariff. So if you would have noted, we have deleted the word progressively determines tariff. So the tariff is to be determined at cost reflective tariff and not, you know, progressively reflects the cost of tariff. So the attempt is that the tariff is actually fixed at which reflects the cost. Similarly, other things ministry is doing, and the basic problem is that the incentives are not aligned. And so as Mr. Tulli was just pointing out, you know, that unless we spell out clearly as to whether electricity is actually a right and is it a public good or a commercial good. Now we all know, you know, that it's a big enabler. So there is no doubt about it, you know, that there is some, there are some features of public good in it that cannot be denied. But having said that, there is also the element of it being a commercial good and costs being incurred to be paid. Unfortunately, in our system, the Electricity Act has not been able to, while, you know, we separated out, we unbundled the SCBs and we got, you know, three different, you know, companies, transmission, distribution, and generation. But the separation, as was mentioned, between the government and the distribution has actually not happened. And where it has happened for the wrong reasons. So operationally, they are one, but financially they are separate. Please note this. I mean, operationally, they are separate. So they are one. So, you know, if theft is not to be curtailed, kisi ka connection nahi kaatna hai, to well, the MLA will ring up and, you know, tell the engineer. If there are, you know, administrative issues, the government will step in. But when there are financial issues, when there is money to be paid by the DISCOM and the DISCOM has to be backstopped, when there was a board, you know, there was a single budget, the board was owned by the state government. No longer. The DISCOMs are separate legal entities. The finance department says that, well, the DISCOM should, you know, manage its own affairs. And so even if it comes to giving a state government guarantee, that is not forthcoming. So now what we have proposed, so the incentives of the state governments of the day are not aligned because they feel that, you know, this problem can be left for tomorrow, governments of tomorrow, you know, to come and solve once you know the problem becomes bigger, we'll have an Uday, we'll have an FRP, and then you know the government of tomorrow will come in, and it will take over the loans of the DISCOM. So the incentives of the state governments have to be aligned. How to align it? What we have proposed in the ministry to the finance ministry, I can share with you, is that the losses and losses of the DISCOMs of any year should be taken over by the state government in the next year. You would recall that Uday made a beginning in this. So we are actually copying, you know, Uday to that extent. People criticize Uday. Some people criticize Uday, but I think one of the good things that Uday brought about was this concept that the losses of the DISCOMs ultimately are the losses of the state governments. And so it said, you know, progressively starting from 5%, I think, to 50% of the losses, last year losses are to be taken over in this year. So 50% is a huge amount, and some of the states will now, you know, be in a fix. And so carrying that concept forward, we have proposed to the finance ministry, and there are some indications that there is a likelihood that it may be accepted, that the losses of the DISCOMs of any year are fully taken over and funded by the state governments in the next year. That will force the state governments to own up operationally and be, you know, more sensitive and take prudent commercial and operational decisions. Similarly, the lenders, Mr. Supratim Dada is here, and there are even the banks, and similarly the FIs under us, the liquidity scheme that we have given is a part-time, it's just a stopgap solution, it's not a permanent fix. So we realize that it is not a solution, it's not a panacea. What is the problem is the solvency problem, it is not the liquidity problem, that is only temporal. And so recognizing that, prudential norms will be introduced even for lending by PFC and REC. And once all stakeholders, which is the political class, the governments, the lenders, they all work towards the solvency of the DISCOMs, whether it is through cost reflective tariffs. You would have seen even in the act, we have proposed a distancing of the regulator, state regulator, which sets the retail tariffs from the government. So that is also, you know, in alignment with this particular thought of having cost reflective tariffs and improving the solvency of the DISCOMs. I think basic problems are, you see, only two. It is, one is, you know, the operational efficiencies. Operational efficiencies come about if the incentives of all are geared towards that. If the government is not, the interests are not aligned with the interests of the DISCOMs, whatever we may do, solvency problem and thus the liquidity problem is not going to be solved. And the second is, you know, cost reflective tariffs. Tariffs in many states, you are all aware, have not been revised, or if they are revised, you know, they were revised very late, by which time the costs have gone up, interest costs have gone up, and so on and so forth. So that is the other thing which this act tries to do through a variety of means, which I have already hinted at. One point that came up was whether, you know, we can mandate that a certain proportion of the disputed amount is deposited before an appeal is allowed to be filed. Well, we'll examine it. This was discussed. I may share that this was discussed. Mostly, to my knowledge, such provisions exist in acts when you know there are taxes involved. And even in cases of taxes, I may tell you, income tax, you know, which are government taxes, which are government monies. Only I think there is no amount which is required to be filed or to be deposited. 15% is required to be deposited in case a stay is wanted. Similarly, in case of excise and GST, I think the amount is only 20%. So while there is an amount, it is not as high as has been suggested. Nevertheless, I mean, I'm not giving my view, but this is one view, you know, which had come up during the discussions, and we'll be open to considering
I think the connection flows.
Yes, and I'll certainly, you know, put a proposal as your comment, so it would come to us in any case, and we'll be very happy to examine it, and we'll take a call on it. I think I've covered, you know, mostly all the points that were raised, but I'll certainly request Fiki and you all to also, you know, put your heads together in another session on how to improve, because that is the root cause, that is the problem, you know, how to address the root cause, and that is the solvency issue, and what all can be done through the act or otherwise. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sanjayji. That's very well covered many, actually all of the issues that were raised. I have one eye on the time, but I do think that we have, with everyone's indulgence, if we can go over by another 10 minutes and then wrap up. I see some questions have started to come in. I think there's one from Balaji, which if I could read it out, is today the biggest problem, and there's no market other than selling to DISCOMs. What is MOP doing to facilitate the opening up of markets and bringing more and more power to be sold in exchanges? And especially since MOP still has a policy of linkage coal to be used only in long-term PPAs. If you could maybe, would you like a response to that, sir?
See, it is a demand and supply problem. There is already, you know, a market. I think there is a well-functioning market. We have a day-ahead market. We have, and although it is only 4.5%, last year was 4.5%, year before that was 4% of the total energy that was consumed. But there is a market. Then now, you know, we have introduced the real-time market. And DISCOMs are free, you know, to buy the power from through, you know, long-term, short-term, medium-term PPAs. We did a pilot, you know, 2500 megawatt pilot bid was second pilot was done for medium-term power. So it is not really, you know, a question of introducing another platform. I think the problem is demand. While our demand is, you know, only one third, per capita consumption is only one third of the whole of the world, you know, average of the world, but still there is not enough. The affordability is not there. So unless affordability goes down, there is, you know, many times, you know, we hear that the demand is there, but the DISCOMs resort to load shedding. And they don't connect. Today, of course, we have almost near universal access. So that is not something which is said. But of course, what is pointed out is that there is load shedding. And so despite there being demand, we are not supplying. I would just like to point out that the demand is a function of price. And there is no DISCOM which would not like to supply if people are willing and consumers are willing to pay. The load shedding generally, unless you know the DISCOM is really is not wise enough, which I doubt, you know, even in the government sector, such so much commercial sense is there. So the load shedding is primarily in areas where there are losses. So it's a function of price. Having said that, government of Ministry of Power is certainly acknowledges that this is an issue, and we are working out, you know, even with the coal ministry, not to link PPA with linkage. This is a dialogue which is going on, because you also raised the issue of linkage coal linkage coal, domestic linkage coal with PPAs. But this is something that we are working on. It is still a work in progress. Thank you.
Thank you. I see several of our power committee members are on. I can see Mr. Bansal. I can see Ravi Chaudhary there. Any questions from your side, gentlemen? Okay, I see a question here from Anoop Singh of IIT Kanpur. Hi, Anoop. It says, to reduce load of the authority, can we consider putting high ticket disputes within its domain while a subnational or a regional level entity handles other disputes?
I really don't know. I mean, how to differentiate, how we can, you know, do that differentiation. But I suppose the point that you are making is that it should not be, the Electricity Enforcement Authority should not be so overloaded.
Capacity constraint.
Another SERC, and it has a capacity constraint. As I mentioned, it can have benches, and we will try to ensure, and you have seen, you know, even for the APTEL, comment was made that I welcome that comment, you know, that even 7 may be less. So we will again, you know, have a look at it. And similarly here in ECEA, if once, you know, it gets through, let's get through, you know, the first post, and then we'll take it on from there and ensure that there are no capacity constraints.
Great. Terrific. Well, with an eye on the time, I just wanted to, before I hand over for the vote of thanks, I just wanted to say that we will be taking some of the very erudite comments made today by our panelists and putting them for summary, and we'll be sending it across to you in the ministry, Sanjayji, and I hope that will be of help. Also, obviously, we are always open for a dialogue if there are further back and forth. Of course, we are always available. I think the ministry, as it stands today, has been very highly open and receptive to suggestions and consultation. So with that, let me hand over to our mentor, Prabir. Over to you, sir.
Yes, Vipul, frankly, I was supposed to give the closing remarks, but the expanse of the discussion and the spread, depth and the width, they have been such that it's just not possible to, you know, spend a few minutes in providing the closing remarks. So, first of all, you know, I have no words, you know, to express on behalf of all of us to say our gratitude or thanks to Mr. Malhotra, who has been all through the discussion. I mean, he has been from start to finish, and in spite of his busy schedule, He has spent more than a couple of hours with us, and he has been really magnanimous in sharing his views, his thoughts, and what he feels needs to be done for the sector, whether it's restoring the solvency, whether it's restoring the creditworthiness, whether it's speeding up with the distribution reforms, whether it's improving the governance part, and answering your question that, you know, whether electricity would at all be a public good, or should it be an enabler of economic transformation? And what we have also seen, that, you know, our challenge is really at the state level, that's one. because the states, you know, cutting across political lines have all said that this is going to be a parallel authority. Our challenge is also to get the message across to a very important cross-section, you know, which constitutes a sector, that's the consumers. The consumer forums, the press, the Cuts International, they have all said that, you know, we would rather strengthen the institutions. So, you know, so they take a different view. So our challenge as FICCI, as stakeholders, would be basically to bring in the concept of stakeholder capitalism, replacing stakeholder activism. So we have to get a very strong message through. But nevertheless, you know, in getting back to what Mr. Malhotra has told us and the viewpoints he has expressed, the thought process that has gone behind drafting the electricity amendment bill, restoring basically the health, financial health of the sector, getting the DISCOMs back on track. You know, we have really been enlightened in the last two hours. I mean, post the discussions we had amongst the panel, and then Mr. Malhotra's observations. Coming back to the panel, you know, again, you know, individually we have to thank them in the sense that, you know, there would need no introduction, Dr. Pramod Deo or Mr. Rakesh Nath. So I would say less said the better, because, you know, they have their own strength in the field itself. Thanks to Supratim Sarkar and Ashish Basu, our colleagues in the sector, and to you as well for, you know, chairing the session and taking it through. Not to speak of Amit, you know, Amit Kapoor, you know, who is quite a legal brain, you know, who has seen the sector through. And I would not be mincing my words if I say that, you know, he is one of the most well-established regulatory lawyers, if I can sort of put that, you know, quote unquote. But you know, thanks also to the participants, who all of whom, you know, have made these exchanges so meaningful, and of course to the secretariat, you know, for pulling this through, and to you, Vipul, as well as chair of the committee. And last but not the least, you know, what I wanted to say is that, you know, we all I would like to you know, have this session ended with a ray of hope. The very fact that, you know, we are discussing dispute resolution is something, you know, which basically says of our intent to get back on track post COVID and get the industry moving on its momentum. So it's with this you know, hope based you know, approach that, you know, we would like to bring the conversation to an end. But also, you know, with the overall view that finally, you know, as Amit rightly said, that, you know, we are not discussing ECA only. It's not mainly and it's not only an adjudicatory body, but we are talking about the subject of dispute resolution as a whole, which would provide a lasting resolution to the miseries we face in the sector. And when we talk of the sector, you know, let me just say, you know, there was a Financial Express editorial only yesterday, which said that who would like to ever invest in the power sector? I mean, if I may say it shortly, and that is what we would like to reverse by way of these kind of dialogues. So thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.